In preparation for Mass, let us pray together a decade of the Rosary. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. For the intentions of Pope Francis and for an increase in our hearts of faith, hope, and charity. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Are they going to turn the heat on?
I'm praying the rosary. Oh. So, hold on just a second, everybody. The resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. O my Jesus, forgive us our sins, save us from the fires of hell, Lead all souls to heaven, especially those in most need of thy mercy. Hail, Holy Queen, Mother of Mercy, our life, our sweetness, and our hope. To thee do we cry, poor banished children of Eve. To thee do we send up our sighs, mourning and weeping in this valley of tears. Turn then, most gracious advocate, thine eyes of mercy toward us, and after this our exile, show unto us the blessed fruit of thy womb, Jesus. O clement, O loving, O sweet Virgin Mary, pray for us, O Holy Mother of God, that we may be made worthy of the promises of Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Good evening and welcome to St. Barnabas. Our opening hymn will be Here I Am, Lord, number 394 in your Breaking Bread, number 394.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ.
And with your spirit.
You may have noticed a new addition to this area over here on the side. We now have a shrine to the Divine Mercy, our Lord Jesus Christ. Now last week, not this week because we didn't have school mass because of the weather, but the school mass the week before, we had the image up. We didn't have the candles in place yet. So we blessed the image, but now since everything's in place, the kneelers and the candles, we're going to go ahead and start off mass by blessing that shrine as a place for prayer. And just to kind of explain the candles, the idea in the Catholic Church is when you make a prayer and you light a candle, as long as the candle is burning, even though you go away, your prayer is still being offered up as long as the candle burns. So at this time, we'll go and bless the shrine. Almighty and eternal Father, in your goodness, bless and sanctify this image of the Divine Mercy, your dearly beloved Son, which has been fashioned to reveal to us the great love of our crucified and risen Savior, the Divine Mercy personified. Help us recall to our minds the streams of blood and water that had gushed forth from his pierced heart to be for us a continuous fount of mercy. Grant to all who invoke your mercy with this image before their eyes the grace of true repentance, pardon, and peace. Shield them from every danger to soul and body in this life. Jesus, our loving Savior, establish in this image the throne of your mercy. Pour out upon all of us who approach it with faith and trust the purifying, healing, and sanctifying rays of grace, ever emanating from it as a blazing star. Gaze upon us as you did from the cross with your great love and mercy, so that we may be filled with your grace. Through this image, may your divine mercy triumph over all the powers of evil. May all who venerate this image never perish. May it be their joy in life, their hope in death, and their glory in eternity forever and ever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. We'll ask Deacon to bless the shrine with me. May this shrine and all who use it be blessed in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now to continue our celebration, let us call to mind our sins and our need for the grace and mercy our Savior offers. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have
mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have
us pray. Keep your family safe, O Lord, with unfailing care, that relying solely on the hope of heavenly grace, they may be defended always by your protection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a high and lofty throne with the train of his garment filling the temple. Seraphim were stationed above. They cried to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. All the earth is filled with his glory." At the sound of that cry, the frame of the door shook, and the house was filled with smoke. Then I said, "Woe is me! I am doomed, for I am a man of unclean lips, living among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphim flew to me, holding an ember that he had taken with tongs from the altar. He touched my mouth with it and said, "See, now that it has touched your lips, your wickedness is removed, your sin purged." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? Who will go for us?" "Here I am," I said, "send me." The word of the Lord.
Amen.
your truth, for you have made great above all things your name and your promise. When I called, you answered me. You built up strength within me. Of the earth shall give thanks to you, O Lord, when they hear the words of your mouth. And they shall sing of the ways of the Lord. Great is the glory of the Lord. In the sight of the O Lord, endures forever. Forsake not the work of your hands.
In the sight of the angels, I will sing your praises, Lord.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. I am reminding you of the gospel I preached to you, in which you received and in which you also stand. Though it is also through it you are also being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. First, I handed on to you as the first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 brothers at once, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. After that, he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one born abnormally, he appeared to me, for I am the least of the apostles, not fit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me has not been ineffective. Indeed, I have toiled harder than all of them. Not I, however, but the grace of God that is within me. Therefore, whether it be I or they, so we preach, and so you believe. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading of the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
While the crowds were pressing in on Jesus and listening to the word of God, he was standing by the lake of Gennesaret. He saw two boats there alongside the lake. The fishermen had disembarked and were washing their nets. Getting into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, he asked him to put out a short distance from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. After he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and lower your nets for a catch." Simon said in reply, "Master, we have worked hard all night and have caught nothing, but at your command, I will lower the nets." When they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and the nets were tearing. They signaled to their partners in the other boat to come to help them. They came and filled both boats, so the boats were in danger of sinking. When Simon Peter saw this, he fell at the knees of Jesus and said, "Depart from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For astonished at the catch of the fish, they had been made, seized him and all those with him, and likewise James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners of Simon. Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men." When they brought their boats to the shore, they left everything and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Have you ever noticed how many references there are in the Bible to specific times and places? For example, in our first reading from the prophet Isaiah, he lets us know that his vision of God happened at the temple in Jerusalem in the year King Uzziah died. But we know from history that King Uzziah died around the year 740 BC. And then in our second reading, St. Paul presents a Catholic profession of faith, outlining the chronology of Christ's death, resurrection, and appearance to the apostles. And in particular, he names one of the apostles Cephas, which was the more familiar name for Peter. And then in our gospel reading, St. Luke records that the early preaching of Jesus took place on the shore of Lake Gennesaret, which we more familiarly know as the Sea of Galilee. So the events in the Bible can always be traced to particular places and times in history. Why is this so important? Why do the writers of Scripture always document these times and places? It's because for many religions, the focus is simply on mythology. Stories about the gods, which occur not in real time, but in some primordial world in a time before time. But our Catholic teachings tell about God's activity within history, and in particular locations, in the lives of historical people who actually lived on this earth. Our God is not mythological, but is the one true living God who, by the incarnation of his Son Jesus, has entered into time and space for the sake of our salvation. This is of great comfort to us because we have a God who cares about us, a God who enters into our lives, a God who walks with us, shares in our dramas, and guides us through this passing world to share eternal life with him in his everlasting kingdom. Let's take a look again at today's readings, and we will find in each of them three things that God does in his work within time and space. The first thing God does in each of these accounts is to make himself known, to reveal himself and his plan for our salvation.
Now, the appearance to Isaiah in the temple was kind of frightening. The entire building was shaking. It was filled with smoke. It's something known as a theophany. A lot of people in the Old Testament were afraid that such a thing would happen to them. But then later on, God came to us revealing himself perfectly and fully, not in some scary way, but as one like ourselves through Jesus Christ. So the first thing God accomplishes always is to make himself known, to reveal himself to his people. Then secondly, God calls to us, inviting us to a relationship with himself, a relationship which is transformative to us, which makes us holy. See, it's not good for human beings to be ignorant of God, for we are God's children, and human life seems to make absolutely no sense if we do not know God. If we don't know God, we don't know ourselves, and we don't know life's true meaning. So God first reveals himself, makes himself known. He calls people to a relationship, an experience with himself that transforms them. And thirdly, God sends us then, in his name and with his authority, to make him known to others. You and I are called by God and sent by him as his messengers to the world. Now we see these three things happening again with Isaiah. He has a revelation from God, and then his experience of God is purifying and transformative, and then God sends him as a messenger to Israel. Likewise, in the second reading, Paul recounts his own encounter with the risen Christ, how it transformed him personally, and how Christ then sent him as an apostle to the Gentiles. And then the gospel reading tells of the fullness of God's revelation in Jesus, the encounter of the first apostles with Jesus, and finally, Jesus promising that he's going to send them out as fishers of men. And now what about us as a parish here at St. Barnabas? Well, as a parish, we are currently focusing on what it means to be disciples of Jesus. And as I've been saying for weeks now, I'm challenging all members of St. Barnabas to focus on three things: faith formation, experiencing Jesus in prayer, and sharing our faith through service. Now, God's revealing of himself and of his plan for us relates to faith formation. Through the formation of the scriptures and catechesis and other activities which inform us about our Catholic beliefs, we come to know God in greater depths. Prayer, whether in community or as individuals, is an encounter, an experience of the living Christ who is always with us whenever we call upon him. And the word apostle means one who is sent. Having received a revelation from God and having experienced him in a personal way, now we are called to share him with others through acts of loving service. In these ways, God is present, is a present reality, right here among us in time and space. We don't have a God who's far off out there somewhere or who's found only in mythological and abstract stories. No, our God walks with us at every moment, wherever we are. This is the promise of Jesus at the end of Matthew's gospel when he commissioned his disciples to go out to all the world. He also said to them, "And remember, I am with you always until the end of the world." So let us each commit to some form of faith formation, to prayer and to sharing our faith through service, that we might reveal to the world the God who became flesh and dwelt among us, the God of space and time. Amen. Part of the faith formation I'm talking about can be fulfilled through participating in a welcome weekend. At this time, I'd like to invite our representatives from Welcome to say just a few words about our upcoming men's and women's retreats. And as they're coming up, some people were asking me why it's so cold in here. The answer is, I don't know.
Good afternoon. My name is Thelma Levens, and I feel like I really don't need to say anything else. Father Guy's just said everything I was going to say. But I do want to invite everyone to participate in a welcome weekend. This year's weekends are at the beginning of Lent, and what a better way to start that season than to come and share, to share laughter, music, people's lives, great music, quiet time prayer, good food, and great opportunities to connect with fellow retreatants. If you've been on a Christ Renews weekend before or a team, you are most welcome, and we would love to have you join us for this experience. Renewal is not a one-time thing. It's an ongoing process, and we invite you to come and be renewed again. It's about 30 hours of time spent without responsibilities or distractions from daily life. This year's Women's Weekend is March 5th and 6th, the first weekend of Lent. What an awesome way to begin preparing our hearts for this season of reflection and study, deepening our understanding of our faith. Please join us for the weekend. You won't regret a single moment of time spent with the Lord in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Welcome. We've been waiting for you.
Hello, my name is Joe Kaufman. The men's welcome retreat was a great blessing for me, but it also opened an eye-opener. It opened my eyes to my faith in a way that it has not been for a long time or ever. For me, life was consumed with raising my four kids with my wife, Rachel. This retreat has pushed me to be more aware of my faith and has pushed me to be the best version of myself. Matthew Kelly, the creator of the Dynamic Catholic, does a great job creating an impactful weekend for everyone. The fellowship, the conversations amongst fellow parishioners of all ages created a memorable weekend. I hope you'll consider this retreat for March 12th and 13th for the men here at St. Barnabas, and just ask yourself, are you thriving or just surviving? The more we get involved with our church and fellow parishioners, the stronger our faith gets, and also provides a better, healthier community and church. I'll leave you with this quote that has resonated with me from Matthew Kelly. Just as life is not meant to be easy, it's not supposed to be comfortable. Be ever vigilant of the role you allow your comfort to play in your trials and tribulations, and at the end of a long day of exertion, but do not become a lover of comfort. Comfort will destroy you long before the difficulties of life. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing your time today. Now let us stand and profess our faith together in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things, visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Trusting in God who promises to hear us when we pray, let us call upon him in the name of his Son.
For the church, may the Lord help each of us live our baptismal identity as priest, prophet, and king. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For nations suffering from violence, oppression, or persecution, may God deliver them and grant them safety and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in our faith community that are discerning a call to the priesthood religious life, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who are sick, especially Dorothy Walker, Joe Bova, Carl Indras, and those in today's bulletin, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, especially Jenny Bushy, Tracy Campbell, mother of Tom and Jeremy Campbell, David Heath, brother of Steve Heath, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for Marilyn Hurley, who is remembering this Mass, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Into your hands, Almighty Father, we commit ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
As our gifts are gathered and prepared, please join us in singing, Lord, You Have Come, number 496 in the Breaking Bread hymnal, number 496.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice and yours to the praise and glory of God.
who once established these created things to sustain us in our frailty, grant, we pray, that they may become for us now the sacrament of eternal life through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you laid the foundations of the world and have arranged the changing of times and seasons. You formed man in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder to rule in your name over all you have made and forever praise you in your mighty works through Christ our Lord. And so with all the angels we praise you as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church, spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Charles our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen, amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
As we come to the table of the Lord to receive the body and blood of Jesus, please sing with us number 330, Lord, you have, or, pardon me, seed scattered and sown. Wrong one. Number 330.
The living bread of God.
Let us pray. O God, who have willed that we be partakers in the one bread and the one chalice, grant us, we pray, so to live that, made one in Christ, we may joyfully bear fruit for the salvation of the world through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
An announcement about next weekend. Next weekend is our annual women's retreat. This will be at the Benedict Inn in Beech Grove this year. I'll be the presenter. I'm very honored to be doing that next week for the ladies. So you have until Tuesday of this week to sign up if you've not already done so. So please contact Kathy Matthews or the parish office, or I think they've got a table set up outside there in the narthex for ladies that are interested. Again, that's next weekend. Also, the bulletins, because of the weather, did not come in, so I apologize for that. So you'll just have to settle for the electronic version that went out through the flock notes. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace. Glorify the Lord by your lives.
Thanks be to God.
As we close our celebration this evening, please sing with us, Holy God, We Praise Thy Name, number 186 in the Breaking Bread Hymn 196.